In this clip, we will have a look at turbulence in the atmospheric surface layer, the layer of the atmosphere just above the Earth's surface. An essential method necessary to characterize turbulence is Reynolds decomposition. In the context of the surface energy balance, we deal with turbulence because it is turbulence that is the transporting agent for sensible heat and water vapor. The surface fluxes of sensible and latent heat flux by themselves are not turbulent. Close to the surface, the transport occurs by molecular diffusion. However, it is turbulence that takes care of the transport in the atmosphere, from a few millimeters above the surface and up. So in order to link the transport at the surface to conditions in the atmosphere, we need to understand how this turbulence transport takes place. This understanding helps us in measuring and modeling those surface fluxes. Furthermore, turbulence itself influences the conditions at the surface, and through that, the surface fluxes. To the left, we see a vertical cross-section through a simulation of a turbulent atmospheric boundary layer. The top cross-section shows the potential temperature field in Kelvin, and the bottom cross-section shows the humidity field in kilogram per kilogram. To the right, the mean vertical profiles of potential temperature and specific humidity are shown, representative of the turbulent fields. The simulated boundary layer is driven by positive surface fluxes of sensible heat and moisture. At the top, the layer is capped by a strong temperature inversion and by a dry layer. You can clearly see the thermals moving upward from the surface, driven by the heating at the surface. Due to the strong mixing, mean temperature and humidity are rather uniform with height. At the top of the boundary layer, the turbulence interacts with the non-turbulent atmosphere above. Non-turbulent air is encapsulated into the boundary layer, so-called entrainment. Due to the entrainment, some dry patches of air enter the boundary layer. Furthermore, the entrainment causes the boundary layer to grow. Our main interest in this course lies in the layer close to the surface. Here, the turbulence is not strong enough to make the mean profiles uniform. We find strong vertical gradients of mean temperature and humidity. This layer is called the atmospheric surface layer and forms roughly 10% of the entire boundary layer. Again, we see organized thermals, but also a lot of seemingly chaotic motion. However, if we look carefully, we can discern some order in this chaos. For illustration, we show two time series here: vertical wind speed at the top and temperature at the bottom. The first thing we can look for is to what extent different variables show similar behavior. Here we see, for instance, that in general upward motions, positive vertical wind speed, coincides with relatively warm air, positive temperature fluctuations. Hence, warm air is moved upward. A second characteristic to look for is the typical magnitude of the turbulence fluctuations, the amplitude. And finally, we see that the signal is not random noise, rather we see some typical timescales of the fluctuations. Now we see in the bottom three graphs the space series of temperature, humidity and vertical wind. And indeed, we see that temperature and humidity are often correlated with vertical wind speed. Furthermore, we can see that the typical fluctuations are about 1 Kelvin for temperature, half a gram per kilogram for humidity, and up to 2 meters per second for vertical wind speed. Finally, a typical length scale seems to be about 100 meters. Now let's see if we can further characterize the relationship between scales and amplitudes, but now for an observed time series. At the top, we see 1 hour of data for the vertical wind speed. What we are going to do is to determine for a range of timescales the typical magnitude of the amplitude of turbulence fluctuations. So let's first try to find fluctuations with a timescale or wavelength of about 500 seconds. Here we have one. Now the sine function that we could fit to that looks like this. And it has an amplitude of about half a meter per second. Next we look for a timescale of 250 seconds. And we find an amplitude of about 1 meter per second, so larger than the one we saw before. Now, if we want to find fluctuations with even shorter timescales, we need to zoom in. So now we consider 10 minutes of data. We look for a structure of 50 seconds length. It has an amplitude of 0.7 meters per second. Now we zoom in further. We look for a structure of about 7 seconds, which has an amplitude of only 0.3 meters per second. A structure of 3.5 seconds has an amplitude of about 0.2 meters per second. And finally, we zoom in even further and show only 6 seconds of data. And now we look for a structure of 0.5 seconds, which turns out to have an amplitude of only 0.1 meters per second. Okay, we've got it now for 6 timescales, the characteristic amplitudes. Now let's put this all together and plot the logarithm of the amplitude as a function of the logarithm of the frequency. And we obtain the following graph. It has more or less one straight part. This is the so-called inertial subrange. The shape of this graph shows a very characteristic aspect of turbulent signals. The smallest scales have the smallest amplitudes. Now that we have a qualitative picture of turbulence, we need to start to tackle turbulence in a quantitative manner. However, there is not yet a closed theory for turbulence, and turbulence, despite its apparent structure, is still too random to describe in detail. Therefore, we usually deal with turbulence in a statistical sense. We describe it in terms of means, variances, covariances, and other statistical quantities. In order to do this, we use the so-called Reynolds decomposition, in which we decompose a turbulent signal, x, into a mean signal and a fluctuating part. Here we illustrate it with a fragment of a turbulent temperature signal. We call this temperature signal x. Now, if we take the mean value of those samples, we obtain overbar x, or the mean of x. For illustration, we assign this mean value for every time slot in the turbulence time series. Next, we subtract the mean signal from the original signal. The result is that we obtain the fluctuating part of the signal, or x prime. It is this last signal that we consider to be the turbulent signal. So any signal is considered to be the sum of a mean signal and a turbulent signal. This sounds rather straightforward. However, the definition and determination of the mean signal is not as trivial as it seems. Consider a variable that both depends on time and space. The time is depicted here as the horizontal coordinate in the green square, and space as the vertical coordinate. Now we are interested in the characteristics of turbulence in the point indicated with the red dot. So at a certain location, say a certain height above the ground, at a certain moment, say 10 minutes past 11 in the morning. In order to be able to make a Reynolds decomposition, we need to construct a mean. So we need more data points for this location and this time. Hence, we would need a number of realizations of the turbulent field that would contain our location and time of interest. So we add an ensemble member. And another, until we have enough parallel worlds to be able to determine the mean value. Well, we all know that those parallel worlds only exist in science fiction movies. So we need to come up with something else. In practice, we perform the averaging either along a temporal dimension or along a spatial dimension. However, for this to work, we need to assume that the characteristics of the turbulence does not change in time or in space. Or in other words, the turbulence is assumed to be stationary and homogeneous. To summarize, we have seen that the lower part of the atmospheric boundary layer is a turbulent layer. Turbulence can be characterized in a number of ways. Some variables are mutually correlated, and the turbulence fluctuations have typical magnitudes for the fluctuations and timescales. And finally, we have introduced Reynolds decomposition as a means to separate turbulent fluctuations from the mean conditions. However, the definition of the mean proved to be somewhat problematic.